Yeah, hello and welcome to Cimbrer Bushcraft Viking Heritage. Today I'm in the Little Wild Bog, and yeah, you can see it's not sunshine today, but it's okay. So I'm out here making a video for you, and you can hear on my voice that I have a bad cold. My voice is very different than it used to be, so bear over with me. Yeah. I have some new stuff I would like to show you today. Among that, I made a new one, a new plate that I can cook my food on. Yeah. I just come closer. Yeah. Yeah, and it's this plate. You can see it's made of iron. 1.5 millimeters, and I just used a plier to make these edges up at, so when I come my oil on, the oil won't fall off the plate. And I just got it welded on this, and this is actually the small version of the fire anchor from TGM Metalworks. I'm going to use this because it's a little bit lightweighter, if you can say that, and yeah, I think it'll work. But this one I'm going to use now for making my bread, and yeah, you saw I have some bacon with me. I'm going to make a bacon and egg sandwich for lunch today. So yeah, I hope you enjoy. Yeah, I think that will do. Three slices. I think that will be enough. Now I think it's done, perhaps well done. I'll just take it off and here, yeah. And then we'll see my first time I'm using this one with oil on. Let's see. Yeah, and of course this is just a plate out of iron, and I season it back home in my oven. You can find videos about how you do that, but it's mainly to put on some oil, and flax seed oil is the best, and then put it in your oven about 300 degrees an hour or so, and then the oil will burn into this iron plate and make it non-stick. Yeah, so it's very easy. I think they're finished. I only have to do my eggs or my egg. I only have one. Yeah. Oh yeah. It's looking good. Just a little salt here. And the bread. Yeah. Bacon and egg sandwich. Mmm. A little bit windy today, as you can see. Skål, everyone! I think I'll put my kettle over so I can cook some coffee.
little squeeze of salt.
Almost boiling. And as the title indicates, I have some thoughts I would like to share with you. It's regarding the name Vikings, because the word Vikings is something that has existed for 1,000 years, and many theories about
where it came from, the name. And I see more and more people saying it's not a particular group, but it's something you do, you go Viking, like you go berserk. So they are saying Vikings is the same as people who are raiding and plundering and raping and all that kind of stuff. And this, they did that, I'm sure that was the case, but for me it's very important that the Viking name doesn't connect to something that is only violence and so on. So I have another theory. It's not one I have thought of or invented, but something I wrote for a couple of months ago, and I've been thinking about that, and it is this theory I would like to share with you. Yeah, and as I said before, more and more people on YouTube and elsewhere I hear that they say the name Viking is something you do. You go out and raid and plunder and so on. And I don't think that there are any proof of that in the Viking history. If you have a proof, if you have proof of that, I would like to see that. But for me, Vikings are more than that. I told you that before. When I was up in Norway this summer, we drove out to the west coast, and almost every second town was something called Vik. It was Sandvik or Narvik or Larvik. It had all the names that ended on Vik. And Vik is a cove or a bay here in the Scandinavian area. In Denmark we call it Vik, and in Sweden Vika. But also in English there's names that are named Vik. These are Lervik, Warvik, Badvik and other Viks in the Great Britain. So, and they are from the Viking Age, and it's the same as we have here in Denmark, Norway and Sweden. Names that are town that are connected or are placed on a cove or a bay. Yeah. So the theory is that it is not Viking, but Vik-ing, yeah. Vik-ing. And yeah, you're thinking, wow, what are you talking about? But in Danish we have some Faroe Islands, we call them Færøerne, and it's named after the sheep that are there, the fair that are there, and these people we call Vik-ing. They come from the Faroe Islands and we call them Vik-ing. And the others names like Islanding. So if you can imagine that the first Vikings that came to Great Britain, and they were asked, where do you come from? And they said, I come from Narvik, or I come from Larvik, or Nesvik, or something like Vik. Then they were Vik kings. They came from a place that was named Vik, or Vik. Yeah. So the theory is it's not Viking, but Vik-ing. Yeah. Hope you understand that. And if you look at it that way, it means that these people that are coming from Scandinavia often lived in areas where there was a Vik and named their town after that. And when they were asked, where do you come from? It was something with Vik. So they were Vik-ings. Yeah. And I said before, this is not something I have found out of, or a theory I just have. There are scientists that are saying that, archaeologists, they are saying the same. And if you look at it that way, it's just a group of people that were coming from a specific area in the north. And yeah, later on they began to plunder and raid the monasteries in Lindisfarne and so on. And of course, these people that were called Vikings, they were connected to violence. So after that, perhaps the name Vikings was connected to something violence. That could probably be true, but I think in the beginning it was not a name for people that were coming and plundering them, but people that were coming from a specific area in the north. Yeah. So please tell me what you think about this theory. I like it because it takes a little bit of the roughness of the Viking Age. I think it's a pity that Vikings are connected to only violence, because most of the Vikings, or the Northmen that were living in that time, were friendly people that were fishing and farming and trading and so on. So I think it's not fair for the people that were living in the Viking Age to connect them to violent people only. I'm sure that the berserker was something that was named after something that was dangerous, and there's a lot of stuff on internet you can read about that. They only, and even the name berserker, they are not they do not agree where it comes from. Some say it's something called a bear, that it was dressed out like bears, and so on. And others say that it has something else to do berserk. So again, that is a name that there are no evidence exactly where it came from and what the meaning was of it. But I'm sure there was they were a group of professional soldiers that didn't have any filter. They just went in and didn't have anything armor on, perhaps no shield, and just a axe or a spear and so on, and they just fought. And I'm sure they were thinking about Valhalla when they did that. And yes, I said before, faring, people are coming from the Faroe Islands, and many towns in Denmark is called Kolding or Herning, and Kolding is means the cold place, and Herning something about horns, Herning or Horning, as it probably was named in the old days. So there's a connection between the word ing and what people are from or what they can do and so on. So I think it's a theory that you should consider, and that should be considered in the society of archaeologists and scientists in, in this area. So, and I just want to, for my part, try to stop the development in this name Viking as something that is only is violence. Yeah. I'm sorry if I'm I have. It's hard for me to explain this in English because I'm not English, I'm Danish, and I have to find the words, the right words, and it's very difficult for me to talk about these things. So I hope you can understand what I'm meaning with this little sharing of my thoughts with you. Yeah. Yeah, when I come out here it was a little bit sunny, but now it's overcasted, and they said that maybe we would have some rain later. I don't hope so, but yeah, it's been a wonderful day out here. Maybe you heard the ravens or the crows that are in this area. It's a very special area. It's a forest, a very old beech forest, and everything, when a tree falls down, it's just laid there and rotten up. And for the environment, it's a very nice area, and for me it's like going back in time, because there are not many forests in Denmark like this. So when I come out here, I think this would look like it would be in the Viking Age too. Yeah, I love it. And now the fall and the winter is coming, and I've been out here making a video once from when I used my tarp, and it was during the winter when there was snow out here, and it is very beautiful too. Yeah, and I was very pleased with this, my new skillet or frying pan that I made. It works great, and I must say I'm impressed that a seasoning of this raw metal can make it so. You saw how the egg was not sticking in this pan. It's amazing how that works. And it's smaller and more lightweight. I can see this one is a little bit wobbly, but I think it'll do. I just have to have this on and this on, and today it worked, and the ground is very wet and moist, so it doesn't stand as well as it will in firm ground. So, and the little I bent this up, it's working great. Yeah, I should just warm it up so I can
take the fat off. The last cup of coffee here before I head home again. Yeah.
Yeah, and I come in contact with a Polish company that are selling stuff for the Viking from the Viking Age and the Middle Ages. Think that are producing themselves. Among that, some awesome tents. And I talked to a guy there, Thomas, and he's sending me one of these Viking tents you can see on this picture, but only the fabric because it's. The planks are going to be almost 3 meters long, so they cannot be shipped to Denmark. But I'll make them myself, and then sometime, perhaps first in the spring, I'll put up this tent and make some overnights there, probably together with Martin. But it's a great company. It's called Maltus, I think. Maltus. I put a link in my video description. You can find that company. And they have furniture from the Viking Ages and other kind of stuff. And they are also going to send me a woolen tarp sometime that I can use when I'm out here. And it does that heavy, and I can use it when I'm sleeping out in the forest or just if it's beginning to rain. It's a woolen tarp that is impregnated with something that is making it not waterproof, but it will shed water when it's rain. I'll keep you updated about how it goes. Perhaps I'll make a little video when I'm doing the planks so you can see how that is. He sent me some pictures and some measurements, so it's just I have to buy the woods and then make some cuttings and so on, drill some holes, and then it'll be ready to set up. It's a very simple tent, and it's a tent that was used in the Viking Age. They know that because in the Oseberg ship up in Norway, they find actually something that looked like this tent. Yeah, it's awesome. Yeah, and in Denmark there's a series in the television about, they call it the first king of Denmark. And for a long time we have said that Gorm the Old was the first king of Denmark, and his son Harald Bluetooth, you all know him, was a great king. But they are going further back in time, and they actually found out that there was another king almost 150 years before Gorm the Old that was a king of Denmark. And yeah, and the funny thing is, when Harald Bluetooth was king, he was also king of Norway. And and the Oseberg ship and Goddard's ship that is up in Norway was plundered. And the same in Denmark. We have a ship down, I can't remember what it's called, Skullelev perhaps. You can see it here, I find out. And it was a grave, a Viking king grave that was plundered too. And yeah, the theory is that it was because Harald Bluetooth didn't want to have any kings before him that was more important, so he plundered these graves and took away perhaps their bodies, much of their stuff. So he erased, he tried to erase the history about these kings so he could be the first real king and the greatest king of time. So it's only a theory, but it's archaeologists in the National Museum that are thinking these saw, so it's very, I think it's very exciting to hear about this. And yeah, Harald Bluetooth was a great king, but he was also a tough king. He built a lot of stuff here in Denmark, ring fortresses and so on. I've been to some of these, and yeah, he had some ambition. And yeah, then he was shot in his ass from by his son Sven Tveskæg, Sven Forkbeard. Yeah, so the Danish history is very violent, and actually Gorm the Old One and Harald Bluetooth is in line with our queen, Queen Margaret II, they can see back in time and say there are blood from that area or that time, from Gorm the Old, Herbrutus, Svendtriskæg, and so on up to now. It's very exciting to read or see about this stuff. Yeah, I've been talking a lot in this video today. I'm sorry for those of you who can't understand what I'm saying. I'm trying to put some subtitles down here. I cannot do it myself, but there's something in YouTube that say that it can be done. And if you can see my videos and you can see subtitles there, please tell me that, because I can't see it here in Denmark. I don't know why. So I would be very grateful for that feedback, because then it means that it works actually. Yeah. I think it's going to be a short video today. The weather is not good, and yeah, you saw I made my meal and so on and talked a little bit about the Vikings here. Hope you enjoyed anyway. And thank you for watching Cimbrer Bushcraft Viking Heritage. I appreciate that very much. And then I hope to see you again on the next one. Bye bye and take care. Hmm.